And then let's bow for a word of prayer, and we'll see what we can learn this morning. We pray this morning for Mrs. Foose, your divine hand of mercy and will to be placed upon her, Father, as she is being ministered to by doctors. But Dr. Jesus, you minister to the entire need that is going on there. Now, Father, the lesson this morning and the preaching today, the communion service, Father, your divine intervention and your divine will to be performed now. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. All right, we did verse 2 where it says the word privy. We're not reviewing. Ananias and Sapphira agreed together to keep some while giving the impression of giving all. Privy, secret, hidden. You know, most people are privy and have all these hidden things. And most people I find over the years are two-faced. They put on one face for somebody, one person, another face for somebody else. And just one big hypocrisy. Possessors, professors, and impressors, right? There are people who try to impress another. And we're probably all guilty of that. And that could tie in with our sermon today. I have, over the years, I had a preacher one time complain about the color of my house. A preacher. And I'm telling you, man, these preachers and people, like, it's like, is there even a brain in their head? What business is it of anybody the color of my house? Is it anybody's business?
City inspector.
There could be an ordinance. There is an ordinance. I remember it came up in Parma once. I'm pretty sure it was Parma. A guy painted one clapboard yellow, and the next clapboard blue, and the next clapboard purple. And I'm just randomly, everyone was a different color. There's an ordinance against that for obvious reasons. Yeah, but I had a guy complain about the color of my house. If I ever complain about the color of your house, tell me to mind my own business. I've had people complain about the ivy on my house. To me. If there's ivy on your house, what difference does it? It's your place. Right? Are shutters hung upside down or right side up on a house? Are shutters hung upside down or right side up on a house?
I never heard of such a question.
They are actually hung upside down on a house today. Shutters are upside down. If you have shutters on your house, they're hung on purpose upside down.
To keep the water out?
That's correct. Exactly. If they're functioning, and then as it was, if they're displayed the way they are on a functioning house, they are then upside down. And so when you close them, it sheds the water, right? People have, it's weird. It's weird. You say, well, what does that have to do with the sermon? It has everything to do with the sermon. Anyway, I might not go over that again. I went over it right now. And I've had people just say weird things, like, mind your own business. You know, I can't even recall going over to somebody's house and complaining about anything, you know? What do I care? Right? All right. Privy, secret, hidden. Possessors, professors, and impressors. All right, verse 3, they lied, in which Satan is the father of all lies, John 8:44. They lied in verse 3. Lying, and we looked those up. I put down the word start. We're going to start there. We're not going to go to Leviticus 19:11, Proverbs 12:22, Colossians 3:9, Revelation 21:8. All liars have their place in the lake of fire, Revelation 21:8. Lying, put away lying, Colossians 3:9. Why is that the old man, you're supposed to put that away? Because Christians lie. They must, and I say it over and over again, that Christians are, it's directed towards Christians, and if the old man does that, you have to put on the new man in Colossians. But put off all these anger, wrath, malice, that's Colossians 3, and put on bowels of mercy, so we're to take the old man off, put the new man on. And so, and that's probably dealing a lot with the sermon today, even though I'm not going to bring those, and none of those things up, we won't be bringing those up, but folks, Christians lie, and so on. And so we're going to start right here. Father, bless now the teaching this morning, Father, that we would glean from your word, Father, and use something that can help us grow now. In Christ's name, amen. Sin begins in the heart. That's where the seed is planted, and so on. Proverbs 4, 23, let's go back there. You know, it's a heart condition. All of this stuff is the heart condition, whether it be good or whether it be evil. It is all a condition of the heart. 4:23, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. It's the heart. That's where these things are hatched, created, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Mark chapter 7, the Gospel of Mark chapter 7. And hopefully you have your notes with you. Oh, by the way, sister, I finished Acts 5, so you can have my notes after. Mark chapter 7. Mark chapter 7, verses 21 through 23. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man. So it's hatched in the heart, and it doesn't necessarily mean that some of these things don't manifest themselves, but they proceed evil thoughts. So it manifests itself in evil thought where it is hidden, yet it didn't manifest itself into action. And when it goes to the next level, then it manifests itself into action. In verse 4 of Acts 5, verse 4, while it remained, was it not in thine own hand? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? In thine heart, thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. All right, so it is conceived and hatched in the heart. And so they conceived this thing in the heart, and then it proceeded to be acted upon. You know, we're going to do this thing. You know, you could say, I'm going to do this thing. And can you abort the mission? You know, you're going to do this thing, and you still have time to abort the mission before you carry it out. They had time to do that. They lied to the Holy Ghost, which is God, which is the Lord. Acts 5:4. He said they lied unto God. 2 Corinthians 3:17. 2 Corinthians 3:17. This 2 Corinthians 3:17, where it states that the Lord is that Spirit. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So the Lord is the Holy Spirit. The Lord is God, the Lord is Jesus, and the Lord is the Holy Spirit. Now we're not going to go and necessarily look that up, but he is. It, you may say, well, isn't that obvious, and isn't... doesn't everybody know and believe that? I'm not talking about outside the church. We're talking within the church. Folks, there are people in the church that don't believe that. And I'm not saying here, necessarily here. We were in a Presbyterian church, and when I found that out, and the preacher had said that there are people here that do not believe in the Trinity, I was just stunned. I was shocked. There are people that do not believe in the Trinity, And they're in these highfalutin, nicey-nice churches. They're wearing suits and ties, and they're very educated, have nice jobs, drive a Lexus. And I tell you, man, it's a mixed bag, folks. And so on. In John 14, verse 17, here in your notes, it says, "Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you." All right, it's the Holy Spirit, called the Holy Ghost, and the Spirit of truth, and he's also referred to as the Comforter. He has many names. Verse 26 of John 15, verse 26, "But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me." All right, so the Holy Ghost is God. All right, filled with the Holy Ghost. We are to be filled with the Holy Ghost. 431, if you back up into Acts 431. "And when they had prayed, the place was shaken, where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost." we are commanded to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Ephesians 5:18. "Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit." All right? We're to be filled with the Spirit. We're commanded to be filled with the Spirit. But in this case, in Acts 5, verse 3, at that point, they were filled with the devil. It says, Why hath Satan filled thine heart? They gave way to the devil, and he had filled their heart. Now, was Ananias and Sapphira saved? You believe they were saved? Pardon? Yeah, I believe they were saved. All right. So, to make you feel better, you might think that there's a whole bunch mess of people not saved. That doesn't make them any less saved, no matter what we think. No matter what we think of my house. No matter what we think of the color of my house. Or whether what we think of the vines that are on my house, or the bats that fly in the chimney of my house, or anything else. what is the reason for the preacher to say he didn't like the color of my house? I've mentioned this before. Anybody recall? And it's none of his blasted business, man.
Flexing muscle.
Pardon?
Flexing muscle.
Oh, on his part?
Yeah.
Oh, he went about doing that on a daily basis, folks. Yeah. Authority where authority. Why not? Why painting it gray? People say, well, it's blue. Well, I don't care what. It's battleship gray. That's what I want. Battleship gray. You say, that's not battleship gray. All right. Complain to Reveille Models. You know, when you build the Missouri. Battleship gray. Nobody knows. It attracts devils. Who knows? No, he didn't have the verse. Brother. Whenever he said brother, you knew you were in trouble. Brother, that attracts devils. Hard bats? No, there was a hole in the caulking, and they can worm their way in there. Man, they'll make it through a hole that big, a slot that big. They'll come in with it. Yes?
What gave the idea that gray would attract the devils?
I have no idea. Pardon? Oh, where's it at? Yeah. Well, his response, if anything was said, his pet answer was chapter and verse, brother. Chapter and verse. Well, I didn't say chapter and verse. Chapter and verse. Yeah, where's the verse? I mean, I don't know. It's like saying, well, don't wear pink. I mean, if the preacher said, if that was the preacher that said, don't grow what? Don't grow something.
Grapes.
Say that?
Grapes.
Grapes? No. No, on your body.
And on your
scalp. Oh, not necessarily.
Facial hair?
Facial hair. It was the first, maybe as a rebel, it was the first and only time I grew a beard. I said, that's it, I'm growing a beard. I went away on vacation, and in 2 weeks I had a full beard, and I came back with it. And a day or two later, maybe I was wrong in doing that, but I grew a beard again. Just like, what are you, you know, preachers come up with weird things, man. If you're married,
good enough for my Lord and good enough for me.
If you're married, you are not to wear what? This is where these people come from. If you're married, what are you not to wear? What do married people wear? You're not to wear a wedding ring. You're not to wear a wedding ring. Now, he didn't get off on that one. He would mention it, saying, I don't believe that. But the facial, I mean, there are groups. In what denomination are they? They're Baptist folks. We don't have to go to the Methodists. Now, the Presbyterians didn't believe in the Trinity. Now, I'm not saying the preacher did, but they were in there. They're in every place, man, folks. Every place you go. But Baptists, I don't have to go to the Christian Science. We don't have to go to, name them off, the Lutherans. All you have to do is just go find your local Baptist church, man, and you're going to find some weird things. And I hope it isn't going on here. And I don't mean, especially when I say going on here, it's starting right there. The pulpit. Let's hope it doesn't go on there. Because then it spills over into this nonsense with the people. And it gets everybody in a tizzy. Just it does. All right, verse 5. They fell down dead. Fell down. They fell down dead. Now I added the word dead in there, but they fell down. Christians can and do fall down dead. They do. Romans 8, let's look at that. People do die. And Christians die for various reasons. Romans 8, 13. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. Now we're talking about that's why men die, even saved men, physically die. I mean, we're all going to die because of sin. The wages of sin is death. But now we're talking the difference between a physical death of mankind and a saint in their spiritual death. Shall never die, all right? You can die if you we're going to have communion today, 1 Corinthians 11, 30. If you take that unworthily, 11:30. I believe today's sermon is a good one for communion. I read old sermons. I haven't read one in a while. It's like pews. I cut the pew down. I was going to sell the pew I had up there. I have one of these up there. And Jim bought one. I bought one. A few people bought the pews, the extras that we had. I cut them down to fit in certain areas. I was going to actually trade it out, trade this one and put mine in here. But it would have gone to the wall and stuck out to the other. And the decision was, I talked to Brother Paul about it. When I say Brother Paul, I don't mean brother, Brother Paul, that it would take up his little corner there. I said, well, no, then the decision, I'm going to cut the pew down. I wanted to avoid cutting the pew down. And to cut the pew down, I can't even get over how I cut these pews down. I cut that pew down, it's a wrestling match. And so I cut the pew down. I then had Ben help me. I made a form to force it to the shape because the ends and the middle are different. It was one big, I got it on it. But the difference in the quality between the old pews that we had old pews, and the newer pews, which are old pews, they both came out of a church from 100 years ago. They made just as much junk back then, folks, as they make today. And I can't remember why I said that.
But it's better junk.
It's better junk. I can't remember why I said it. Oh, well, it doesn't matter. We're going to serve communion today. For this cause, many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. So if you receive it unworthy, it just scrap what I said. There was a point there, but I failed to remember. And man, I am getting more and more forgetful. No, I can't remember why I said that. I brought it up for a reason.
Well, they fell down dead, and you started.
Had nothing to do with that.
You forgot to remember.
I can't remember. Anyway, if you receive that unworthily, it is sin, and you can die from that. Many sleep. In the eyes of the Lord, those that sleep, are dead are but sleepeth, and they laugh Jesus to scorn, and so on. It is Psalm, the sleep of death. What is that? Psalm, is that 116? Or Psalm, is it verse 13? Psalm 13, sleep the sleep of death. Anyway, it's a psalm. And we go there to show that it is, as a little child looks at somebody in the coffin and said, "Look, mommy, they're just sleeping." Because in God's eyes, they are. All right. For sin. 1 John, there is, as it says in 1 John 5, there is a sin unto death. A sin unto death. In 1 John 5, verses 16 and 17, just before it says, the whole world lieth in wickedness. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There's a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray. All unrighteousness is sin. But there is a sin unto death. You can do something grave enough that God says that that's it. Eli's kids. Here's how preachers run. That priest Eli was no good. He wasn't a very good father, right? His two sons, it turned out bad, right? Now, when you're caught off guard like that, you actually take your breath away when they want to condemn you. It'll actually take your breath away. And preachers do that, and the elite do that. A good response, then, if Eli is this way, we'll go to another priest. Or another, help me out, not a priest, he was a line of, what do we call him? No, he wasn't the high priest, Eli. There was 13 of them in a row. The
saints.
I can't think of the word right now. Judges. A judge. Well, look at Eli. He was a good man. And this makes for great preaching, but it's just utter nonsense. He was a good man, but he was a weak man. Well, then go to the next one. What about his kids? Samuel was rough and tough, and Samuel told it like it was, and his sons were no good. His sons were no good. Bible says that. All right, what about the first priest? What's his name?
Aaron.
Well, what about his two? He had four. What about his two?
Two will be slain.
Boom! Uh-oh. And then, what do you say about Aaron? All right? Throw it right back in their face. All right? What about Aaron's sons? What about Samuel's sons? What about Eli's sons? And so on. All right, so sin. People do sin. Isaiah 57:1. What did they say about the blind man in John 9? What did the apostles say there?
Born in sin.
Did he sin or did his parents sin? I'm telling you, this is just how people run. It's knee-jerk. It's mostly jerk. And what did Jesus say? Neither. But this was done for the glory of God. Okay. Isaiah 57:1, the righteous perisheth. All right? They died at Stalingrad. Right? And no man layeth it to heart. And merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. Amen? Hey, before the war started, when did the war start? September 39? September. So in August, there was a 17-year-old boy who died in Germany. And he could have been taken out of the way before he was killed. On any front. Right? Who are we to judge this stuff? All right, carnal people and spiritual people are numbered together. Go to Acts chapter 1. Yeah, they might respond, well then, well, that's Old Testament. What about New Testament? Well, then don't bring up Eli. Yeah. Acts 1:17. He was numbered with us and obtained part of this ministry. Who was numbered with them? Judas was. He was numbered with them. I don't know why I put that question in there. Why not a believer? I can't remember why I did that. Exodus 12:38. It said, those that had gone up and out of Egypt, the children of Israel, it said they went up with a mixed multitude. Well, then what would have been the mixed multitude?
Egyptians.
Some of the Egyptians. Because nine plagues already came through. And then some of them figured out, we're going to have the 10th. Right? We're going to have number 10. We better get that blood of the lamb up there. And who's to say, and now it doesn't record that, but isn't to say some of the Egyptians didn't do that to avoid having their firstborn slain and coming out with them, yes?
Whoever was inside the house was saved.
And by the way, where does that state that? Rahab. If they weren't in there, they were not saved. Where else? Acts chapter 27. If they don't remain in the ship, remember they cut the ropes off and they were faking it. They were going to put the lifeboats out and they were pretending. They wanted to do this on the sly. And Paul caught them and said, and the soldiers cut it off. Otherwise, they cannot be saved. Rahab's house, they cut the boats off. You got to be in the house. Cannot be saved. All right, the wheat and the tares, Matthew 13, in the parable there, Matthew 13. Matthew 13, 24 through 30. Another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat, went his way. Now, folks, I don't believe those tares are saved. Those tares are lost. They're lost people. They're sown in amongst the believers. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, didst not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then hath the tares? He said unto them, An enemy hath done this. The servant said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, Nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together first the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. All right, you say, well, you got tribulation saints and you got the reaping of the earth. There's two angels that go forth sometime during the trib, and one reaps, and those angels go right, I think it's Revelation 16, one reaps, that is a rapture during the trib. They're taken out, and the rest, man, are killed. Killed. So carnal people and spiritual people are numbered together. It's a mixed multitude. I know that in class, Doc would say, Do you think everybody here is saved? He wasn't referring to class. He wasn't referring to the class, even though we could include the class. Do you think everybody here is saved? We're talking about 2,000. Basically, come on. They're not. They're not saved. And who is he to judge? But according to the verse, I could go there and point and say that's true any place. I am not here to judge that. By their fruits ye shall know them. Now it said the tares in that parable, and then the fruit came. By their fruits ye shall know them. In the context, by whose fruits? Anybody know the context?
Holy Spirit?
No, it's the preacher, the prophet, the one that came, the false shepherd, the wolf, the false shepherd, when he sees the wolf come, it's in that context. It doesn't have anything to, you know, they can preach, by their fruits you'll know. It's a direct reference to him and not you. That's what I'm just going by what the Bible says. That's what it says. Verse 4, Ananias and Sapphira lied long before they got to church, right? They conceived it in their heart, made the plan. It was done long before. They lied to God. They lied to the whole, verse 4. They lied to the Holy Ghost. They were tempted the Spirit of the Lord, verse 9. And Peter said unto him, How is it that ye agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? And they lied to men. And Peter answered, verse 8, Tell me whether you sold the land for so much. And she said, Yea, for so much. They lied, tempted the Spirit of the Lord, and they lied to men. In verse 4 it says, Was it not in thine own power? Folks, we have things that are in our own power. Own power. Meaning they have the right to do what they're going to do. They had the right to do that. They had the right to either retain the money, give the money, break the money up, etc. They had the right to do that. All right, skipping over now, where do we go? To verse 9 there? Did I skip a page or no? No, I did not skip a page. Peter said unto her, verse 9, And Peter said unto her, Go to, if you would, to 1 Timothy 5. 1 Timothy 5, 20. Now, I might look this verse up again. It says, Them that sin rebuke before all, that others also may fear. Now he did that there. I have seen on film on film. When I say film, you know what I mean. DVD. Come on. When I say the slide projector presentation, I don't say PowerPoint. It's the slide projector. We all know what that means. All right. Rebuke before all that others may fear. All right, we all have, and he did that, church early on. In the context of that verse, who's to be, in 1 Timothy 5, who's to be rebuked? Pardon?
No.
Yeah, you know what? I remember where I was standing. And we have done certain things in the church and done them a certain way. I was standing right here. I was standing here. I remember where I was standing when it happened. Mary Ann Mihalicek was here. Remember Mary Ann Mihalicek? Who did she bring that morning? Anybody remember? She brought a friend, and she was black. I remember that. Anybody remember that? You don't remember that. And I used that verse. And that woman took my breath away and said, that's for an elder. And shouted out what the verse meant. And after that, I changed my opinion. I went to then what I read normally. And in reading it, it is meant for an elder. It's meant for an elder. In the context of that, look at verse 19. It begins, rebuke not an elder, in verse 1. Look at verse 19. Against an elder, receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses. Now, once the witnesses are there, it says, then that's in rebuke before all. It's not a random verse. It is in its context. That's what you're to do. All right, and in the verse, it says, well, when you have this kind of a problem like in Acts 5, that it needs to be really weighed and done correctly. Really weighed and done correctly. But he did, and he said unto her, and he didn't wait around. Peter didn't wait around. Verse 11, great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things, afraid of the thought of dropping dead in their tracks, right? If somebody drops dead in their tracks, man, that would put a lot of brakes on a locomotive, right, as it goes. And God does warn. Revelation 2, verse 5, and we're way over. We're going to stop here this morning. Revelation 2, verse 5. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen. Do people fall? Have you fallen lately? Some of us here, folks, I lived a saved life, but I was lost. You know, I didn't gamble, I didn't drink, I didn't go to bars, I didn't do that stuff. I didn't do that stuff. So when the woman comes and wipes the hair, the feet of Jesus with her hair, she was a great sinner. And Simon wasn't. And Simon loveth little. Amen. God does warn. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works, or else I will come unto thee. Now, we're talking about a church here, but individuals make up churches. Or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent. So God does warn. And we're going to pick it up here. It's a new paragraph marking. We'll keep it in the context of the outline and so on. It's the miracles in the church, and they did occur. Yes?
Isn't that more or less in the sin of omission and commission? One, you don't do something you should do. Another one, you do something.
I did preach on that, the sin of omission. I preached a message on that once.
But
you know,
it looks like it's
by neglect. Yeah. Anyway, Father, bless now the preaching, Father, in Christ's name.